Johnny Dollar.
Well, now, how are you, Johnny? This is Ripley Tita, Worldwide Mutual Insurance.
Well, hi, Rip. How's dear old Memphis, Tennessee?
Finest town on God's green earth, Johnny. Always was, always will be.
Well, now, when did you join the Chamber of Commerce?
What's it?
Say, isn't this about time for your big annual celebration?
Oh, you're too late, Johnny. Cotton Carnival's all over and done with for this year.
Now, you should have called me sooner.
Well, now, why, Johnny? These fine people here in Memphis never give us any trouble.
Well, what are you calling about?
Trouble, Johnny. Real big trouble.
I thought you just finished telling me.
Yeah, I did, Johnny. This little problem I'm calling about happens to be over in the nearby town of Somerville.
Well, now, make up your mind, Rip.
What's it?
Well, which is it, a little problem or big trouble?
Well, now, I suppose that kind of depends on just how you look at it, Johnny.
Look at what?
Murder.
Murder?
Yes, sir. Murder.
Expense account submitted by Special Investigator Johnny Dollar to the Worldwide Mutual Insurance Company Memphis office. Following is an account of expenses incurred during my investigation of the stock in trade matter. It was bright and early in the day. I was able to make an immediate plane reservation, so expense account item one is $72.75, airfare to Memphis, Tennessee. And by shortly afternoon, we started circling for a landing over the big industrial city there on the eastern bank of Ole Miss. Soon as I cleared my baggage at the airport, I spent item two, $6.25, for a taxi into Ripley Tita's office on Union Street near 3rd.
Taxi, Johnny? Now, why didn't you all just rent yourself a car at the airport? Well, sit down.
Thanks.
I'll have my secretary get one for you.
Yes, sir?
Maribel, honey, have one of those nice rental cars brought around front for Mr. Dollar, huh?
What time?
Right away. Thank you, honey.
You mentioned something about a town called Somerville.
Yeah, about 45 miles sort of east of him.
What happened over there?
Like I told you on the telephone, Johnny, murder. And the deceased is a client of ours named Avalny Beauregard Exum.
That's a mouthful.
That's three mighty fine old family names, Johnny.
That figures.
Yes, sir. Anyhow, early this morning, his housekeeper found him laying over his desk with his head bashed in.
Have the police over there any theories, anything to go on?
No, sir, not a thing. No fingerprints on that heavy andiron that was used on him. No clues of any kind, nothing. So that's why I think maybe you ought to go over there and take a look around.
How big a town is Somerville?
Oh, less than a couple of thousand, I guess.
I see.
Now, that used to be the heart of some real important plantation country. That's where the Exum money came from, Johnny, from cotton. But by the time it got down to Volney Beauregard, well, he was still living in the old plantation house, but most of the property around had all been sold off.
In other words, old Exum wasn't worth very much money.
And I'm afraid that's true, Johnny. But he somehow managed to keep up the payments on his insurance.
How much?
Well, face value,
$35,000. Mm-hmm.
I don't rightly know just where he got his living income from. Of course, after the war, when some of these fine old Southern families had to sell off the land, they made some investments and things.
You mean the Civil War, Rip?
I said the war, didn't I?
Go on.
Well, anyhow, I don't really know where he got his living money, except maybe from his kinfolk.
Well, that brings up the question of beneficiary.
Those very same kinfolk, Johnny, only ones he got left.
Who are they?
Well, no wife or young uns of his own, so let's see here on his policy.
Yeah.
Just a niece and a couple of nephews, Johnny. Now, let's see, there's Clarabelle Otway Exum.
You have her address there?
Let's see.
Well, just let me use this scratch pad. I'll copy the policy.
Yeah, go right ahead. And like you see, she lives right here in town. Works in a five and dime, I understand. And there's a nephew, also named Avalny Beauregard Exum. Lives down Corpus Christi, Texas, ain't he?
All right, I got it.
Then there's other nephew named a Culpepper Van Buren Oglethorpe, right there in Somerville. Works at a real estate office. Although it beats me how he makes a living at it. Yeah, that's all, Johnny. Guess those three.
Okay. In other words, they're the only ones who will benefit by Exum's death, huh?
Well, now, that's right, Johnny, but surely you don't think one of them could have killed him.
Why not?
Fine old Southern family like that.
Did he have any enemies that you know about?
Fine old man like Volney Beauregard Exum.
Did he have any friends?
Well, no. No, I guess he didn't, really. Kind of just kept to himself, living out his days there on the plantation house. All alone with just his pride, just living out his days.
Now, you mentioned a housekeeper.
Yeah, well, Miss Dollicato just did some day work for him. And don't you go suspecting her, Johnny, why she couldn't hurt a fly.
Well, you are a lot of help. Well, maybe I better not suspect anybody, huh?
That's right. What I mean to say is...
35,000, three beneficiaries.
Yes, sir.
Equal?
Yes, sir.
So maybe 11,000, 12,000 apiece. That's not very much.
Well, now, I understand they'll share the rest of the estate, too.
Oh, what do you think that plantation's worth?
That old rundown house and the little bitty piece of land where it sits, maybe 10,000's all.
No idea what kind of money old Exum had to live on, where it came from?
No, bank accounts or nothing, Johnny. He even paid cash premiums on his insurance. I guess he didn't like banks and such.
Well, you sure don't give me much to go on. One more question. Did the killer ransack the house?
Well, no, not that I know of. So maybe you better take a look, huh?
Yeah, Rip, I think I'd better. Driving to Somerville to look over the scene of the crime, I checked up on Mr. Exum's niece, Clarabelle. I found her in the stockroom of the 5 and 10 where she worked. She was a thin, wan-looking girl of about 30 with long, black, stringy hair badly set in a knot that bobbed about the back of her neck as she talked in a high, nasal voice that fairly set my teeth on edge.
Excuse me while I set this box of ribbons.
Sure.
And if you all want the truth, Mr. Dollar, I am just as glad as I can be that old Uncle Volney died.
He was murdered, Miss Exum.
Well, he's gone anyhow. And when I get my share from his insurance and that property, I can pay all my bills and buy myself some fancy new clothes and lots of things.
Well, then you're not at all sorry about this?
Of course not. He had nothing to live for anyhow, Mr. Dollar. Nobody to talk to except for Miss Cato 2-3 times a week when she comes to claim.
Poor Mrs. Cato. How poor, Clarabelle?
Oh, well, actually, she probably has more money than Uncle Volney ever has. Kind of some of her kinfolk dying and leaving all that big property over to Whiteville. See, she was a Beaufort on her widowed sister's husband's side.
Yeah, well...
And when her cousin Sally mate, she had some Beaufort blood and kin, too.
I see.
And when she died, with all the money and things from her cousin once removed... And now, wait a minute. He was her father's nephew's half-brother, is what it was.
Yeah, thanks. Well, I'll take your word for it. Now, this Mrs. Cato, if she had money, why did she work as a housekeeper?
Oh, just out of pity for Uncle Volney, him being all alone and all.
Didn't you ever go out to see him?
He never did want to see me, did he?
I wouldn't know.
No! All he cared about was sitting there counting his money and keeping his relatives from getting any of it, except maybe Culpepper. And now we'll get it anyhow, Mr. Dollar.
Where did his money come from, Clarabelle?
Don't you know, Mr. Dollar?
No.
Well, now that's funny.
All right, so it's funny. Now, where did the money come from?
Oh, I don't know. I thought you did. Now, excuse me, I gotta get these boxes put away. Lest my boss comes back here and sees me just sitting and talking. Boss don't hold much for me.
More questions, more useless answers. Little old Clarabelle simply didn't know anything that might be helpful to me and didn't care, except, that is, whatever money might be coming to him. Maybe the Exum family was smart and prosperous once, but if she was any criterion, they'd done mighty poorly in the last couple of generations. I knew this. If she had anything to do with her uncle's death, she'd probably have left signs all over the place. So I drove on over to Somerville to the Exum home, or rather what was left of it. 100 years ago, it might have been a mansion, but now it was just a wreck. 2 of the 8 big columns on the front had fallen and simply left there to rot away in the sun and rain. Windows were broken and stuffed with newspapers to keep out the draft. There hadn't been a paint job in 20 years, at least. What little was left was cracked and peeling. The yard was nothing but weeds and moss, and a thick matting of leaves that never had been raked from under the big trees that were hung heavily with Spanish moss. At the door, I was met by a Sergeant Aiken of the local police.
Real glad to see you, Mr. Johnny. That Mr. Teeter from the insurance company phoned you'd be here. Come on in, sir.
Thank you, Sergeant. I'd like to see just where and how Mr. Exon was murdered.
Yes, sir. Right in here in the library. Only I guess the old man must have sold off all his books a long time ago. Now, here, sir. You see, here he was kind of sprawled across the desk there. What's left of it. With that tin box by him pried open.
Now, where is the body now?
It's in town for the autopsy, him being all alone when he was murdered.
His housekeeper wasn't him?
She's the one come in early this morning to do her work and found him laying here dead.
I see. Go on.
Well, it's all pretty obvious, Mr. Johnny. Somebody just come in here, found him sitting here with this little tin box in front of him.
What was in it? May I touch it?
Oh, yeah. Might as well. We couldn't find a single fingerprint on it. Not even Mr. Exon.
No prints at all?
No, sir. No prints at all. Chief, he knows about them things. He went around with a kit for prints, dust and everything. Yeah, whoever did this must have worn gloves and also wiped off everything he touched just to be absolutely sure. Yeah, must have been real careful.
I see.
Even this heavy andiron he used to kill him with. Chief even checked the doorknobs, everything else for prints.
Any idea, then, how the killer might have got in?
Chief and I have been through the place with a fine-tooth comb, Mr. Johnny. You ask me, the old man must have let him in.
When?
Doc says he's killed sometime late last night.
Late?
Yes, that's right.
Well, then, what I've heard about Mr. Exon, it had to be somebody that he knew pretty well.
Yes, sir. But trying to find anybody he knew that well, this old recluse. Anybody he'd let in at night, the chief had a couple of the boys working on to her, but I don't see how they're going to come up with anybody.
Any idea what might have been in this old tin box?
Well, probably whatever money the old man had on hand.
Where'd he get his money, Sergeant?
No, that's a good question, Mr. Johnny. I know that he never had any bank accounts, but he would cash a check now and then.
Well, if he had no account, I
and
can't...
He never sold any real estate for the last 25 years. Didn't have any to sell except this old place here.
Well, this box certainly couldn't hold enough to keep him going for... Now, wait a minute. What's this?
Looks like a couple pieces of paper stuck there in the hinge.
There's a corner of something torn off. Let's see if I can get it out without more tearing.
Them corners weren't tore off of any money. That's for sure.
No. No, this looks like a sort of parchment paper that's used for an insurance policy. Or maybe that's where his money came from.
What are you thinking of, Mr. Johnny?
Two possibilities, Sergeant. One, the obvious one, that he had a lot of money hidden away in some secret place around this house.
Well, now, we thought of that.
On the other hand, if these torn-off corners, freshly torn, too, I believe, if they mean what I... Allison, there's a nephew living right here in Somerville, isn't there?
Yes, sir. Yes, there is.
Big enough to have wielded this heavy andiron so effectively?
What, sir?
Well, certainly Clarabelle couldn't have done it.
Well, Mr. Johnny, you're talking about his own kinfolk.
Besides, she's too stupid to have covered her tracks.
Well, now, if you're talking about stupid...
Yeah?
Well, that nephew on his mother's side,
mm-hmm.
that Culpepper Oglethorpe living here in town...
Yeah?
I mean, the one supposed to be working at real estate, but he ain't. Kind of, he ain't doing anything. All he ever got was from his uncle.
Go on, Sergeant.
Well, he's so stupid that maybe he would kill one of his own kin.
Where is he?
Of course, I suppose so. Most anybody kills for money, though.
Where will I find him?
And you know, none of them three had any use for old Lexham. And only one of the boys could have used this heavy andiron.
Sergeant.
And with Culpepper, the only one of the boys near enough to do it, you know.
All right, where is he? What?
All I said was, oh.
Come on, Sergeant.
No, sir, Mr. Johnny. Culpepper didn't do it.
Well, how do you know? How can you be sure?
Well, it seems he had some trouble a couple of weeks ago. Pulled a knife on a man.
Well, then he is the type.
He may be the type, Mr. Johnny, but, ever since he's been locked up in jail. Still is.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
Frustrating case, this one. There was nothing I could really put my finger on. The Somerville police were doing just as much as I was and were accomplishing just as much. Nothing. What about the other nephew, who also bore the name of Valney Beauregard Exum? Rip had mentioned that he lived in Corpus Christi, down in Texas.
Yes, sir, Mr. Johnny. 5 or 6 years, I'd say.
What does he do down there, Sergeant?
Well, I don't know that, sir. All I know is he had a fight with his uncle once. Mr. Exum gave him money to get out of town, so he did. He hasn't been back.
I wonder.
When I phoned him there in Corpus this morning and told him what happened, he said he was sorry that he couldn't get down here. He was pretty tied up, but he'd be glad to pay for a decent funeral.
I'm sure he would. As if these torn-off corners of paper are what I think they are.
Yeah, it looks to me like young Volney Exum's the only one that's any good of them three. Yes, sir. I mean, if he can afford a nice funeral for somebody...
You bet he can. Now, listen, Sergeant, maybe I'm all wrong in playing a hunch that one of his relatives killed the old man, but it's all I've got to go on.
I'll say this, Mr. Johnny. A hunch is no kind of proof.
I know, and proof is what I need. But even without it, I'm going down to Corpus Christi. Believe me, I'll be the first to admit it. To admit that luck, sheer luck, is what helped me to solve this one. It came by way of a pile of letters just inside the mail slot by the front door. On top was an envelope with a familiar company name across the upper left-hand corner. Intrastate Telephone Company. Before the sergeant could stop me, I tore it open. And sure enough, a dividend check for $250. With Intrastate Telephone paying 50 cents a share, and I know because I own some of that stock myself... Here was a dividend on some 500 shares, over $40,000 worth. All right, expense account item 3, after a mad drive back to Memphis, $51.50, plane fare to Corpus Christi. It was late by then. So item 4 is $22 even, and that includes a cab into the Robert Driscoll Hotel, cocktails and dinner, and my room bill for the night. First thing in the morning, at a brokerage office on Lawrence Street, I was talking to my old friend Wayne Stockford.
Well, to answer them in order, Johnny... I'm fine, thank you. And I do think ours is the biggest stockbroker's office here in town. And yes, we do have a client by the unlikely name of Volney Beauregard Exum. But it's a very small account, though.
Is he a young fellow, Wayne?
Oh, I'd say somewhere in his 30s.
I know how it is. A client's business is confidential.
Why don't you ask him?
What?
He called a little while ago. Seems that he has some old securities that he wants to cash in. And he... Oh, wait a minute. There it comes now.
Intrastate Telephone.
Well, that's right. How the world did you ever...
Right over here, Mr.
All right, now, I'll sit over here at this other desk. Now, pay no attention to me.
Look, Johnny, I don't understand. Morning, Mr. Exum.
Morning, Mr. Stark, sir.
Sit down, won't you?
Thank you, sir.
Now then, Are these the two certificates that you want to cash in?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. All right. We'll just sign these over to us. Sign right here, if you will. I believe there's a little ink in that pen.
Right here, sir.
Yes, sir. Right. That's quite a bit to sell all at once.
I know.
I must say, I didn't realize that you had this sort of business.
I want cash for these, Mr. Stark, sir.
All in cash?
I gotta make a business trip. Maybe gone sometime.
Well, I don't know, Mr. Exum. Let's see. This has come to over 40,000.
Now, look here, sir. I'm an old customer.
Yes, I know that's true.
So, here you are. Just get me the cash and I'll be on my way.
Don't bother, Wayne.
What, Johnny?
I said don't bother. Just call a policeman.
Well, who are you, sir?
Call a cop, Wayne. These signatures are forgeries.
What are you talking about? You trying to say that I ain't... That I'm not Volney Beauregard Exum? You tell him, Stockson.
This is Volney Beauregard Exum, John.
Sure it is, Wayne, but these signatures are forgeries.
You're crazy.
They were stolen from his uncle up in Memphis, also named Volney Beauregard Exum, and they were stolen from him when this man murdered him.
Murdered him?
You think you can prove that?
I can prove it, Exum.
Now, listen
with
here.
With two little pieces of paper that you left behind in a tin box where your uncle kept these stock certificates.
No, I didn't leave anything.
Look, do you see how these corners tore off fit perfectly on these certificates?
I thought I took everything.
You mean after you killed him?
Yes. No, let me out of here.
Stop him, Johnny.
Stick around. Exum. You want to call the police now, Wayne?
Yeah.
Exum didn't know, of course, was that Wayne would have done a lot of investigating before handing over all that money. In spite of the way that he'd carried a small account of the firm to set things up for the murder and robbery. Expense account total, including the trip back to Memphis and then back to Hartford, we'll call it 325 even. Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.
Now, here is our star to tell you about next week's story.
For next week, one of the cleverest rackets in jewelry that I ever saw. Over $1 million worth. Join us, won't you? Yours truly, Johnny Dollar.